What I came to talk to you all about today was both the water and sanitation crisis globally, but then also water.org as a social enterprise and what the organization is doing about it. So I would love for this to be as interactive as possible. Raise your hands, ask questions. I'd like to answer and address different people's perspectives, because I realize there are some people here who are more interested in the global water crisis and what global water security means to the globe right now, which is a little bit different than maybe some of your interests in water.org as a social entrepreneurship type of organization. How does that work? What's the culture? How do we get funding? So just raise your hands as you guys have questions. I think that we're good here. So I'm going to show you guys. I promise I'm not going to death by PowerPoint you. And I'll just walk through some slides just to have the conversation. So as I mentioned, there's almost 1 billion people in the world, 780 million people. So that's about one in seven people don't have access to just basic drinking water. And so if you can imagine the toll that that takes in terms of time, in terms of funding, financial toll, health toll, it's a rather large crisis. In fact, there are more people in the world that we tweet this factoid a lot. There's more people in the world who have access to a cell phone than they do to a clean glass of water. And that is probably the most popular tweet that Nick Kristof retweets us. When we put that out there, more people are like, you've got to be kidding me. Like, it's just a crazy statistic to think that you can probably make a phone call faster than you can get access to a glass of clean water. And again, in this country, that's sort of mind-boggling, because right now, like I said, I can walk 2 seconds around the corner here and just fill up my cup of water. And by the way, the drinking bottled water here in this country, I mean, think about how much bottled water we drink versus the fact that folks who are living every single day in water insecurity are drinking water that we probably wouldn't even drink, even if we had access to it. So quality is a really big issue as well. So as I mentioned, this takes a real toll on global economies. So those who are interested in just global development and who may be focusing on economics, this for every dollar invested, there's about an $8 return in GDP growth. When you invest in clean water and sanitation, it really underpins everything. It underpins literacy rates, healthcare statistics. A child every 21 seconds under 5 will die from a preventable diarrheal disease. Diarrheal disease is actually the second largest cause of death of children under 5 in the world. That's more than HIV, AIDS, malaria, and TB combined. So it really is a global health crisis. More than anything, I think, first and foremost. And then, of course, the drain financially on the economy and on families is pretty significant when you think about just overall infrastructure in some developing countries. If you're spending, you know, hours per day walking for water, you're not spending that time being economically productive. One thing I just wanted to point out is that this is predominantly a woman's burden. In most countries where we work at water.org, especially, the people that are most affected by this water crisis are women. Those are the folks who are every single day walking for water, queuing for water, boiling water, and doing it multiple times per day. It's also, in terms of sanitation, a significant burden on women, because you're often waiting till the fall of darkness to practice open defecation. If you don't have access to a toilet, it doesn't get any less embarrassing. I was in Los Angeles for World Water Day, and there was we were lucky enough to have this event thrown for water.org as a fundraiser, and it was a photo exhibit, and there was these beautiful photos, and people were dressed head to toe in like thousands of dollars, you know, these beautiful women, you know, and I just basically said, ladies, can you imagine having to wait until right now when it's dark outside, and now all of you guys need to queue up and go to the bathroom outside? Like, can you imagine that? Having to wait all day, because it doesn't get less embarrassing. Just because you live in a different place or you came up in a different place doesn't mean it's any less awkward to have to pull down your pants and go to the bathroom outside in front of everyone. Men, women, and so women wait until darkness to do that. And you should have seen the reaction. These women were like so uncomfortable that I was talking about open defecation publicly. in the setting. And it's, I mean, it's just a visceral reaction, I think, especially for women to have to think about that and what those choices are. And so it can be a real danger. One of the areas where we have been working in Kenya, actually, where there's been a spike in increased crime against women, assault on women, because women are waiting until fall of darkness. And so there's one community where we've really had to double down and bring in other NGO partners who are working on gender equality issues, because it's that it really becomes, as I said, this really complicated, intricate challenge that you're trying to solve. It's not just access to water, but there's all of these other social and economic issues that come along with that. So I really just wanted to use this slide to point out to especially especially women here in the audience that it really is a woman's burden, and it's probably, if nothing else, we try to explain, especially to funders and donors and partners, that if you want to support women's empowerment, this is the key issue. I can't think of a bigger issue than this. So this is really where water.org is different, and where we believe that there has been decades of good work that has been done in terms of water and sanitation. There's a lot of NGOs out there who are putting wells to good use, rehabilitating them, building them. I think a lot of people, when they think about the global water crisis, they think about these taps and these wells, and you know, children's faces lighting up, and you cut a ribbon, and it's a big ceremony, and there's a plaque, and that's been done for decades. And Gary White, when he first started working on this issue, this was his challenge. He was sort of trying to wrap his head around, you know, we're a great NGO, we're finding great local partners, we're putting in these systems, but we can't guarantee that they're going to last, and who's going to take care of them after we're gone? And doesn't it sort of feel like we're just putting more holes in the ground, and we're raising money to put in a new system, and then we're raising money to put a new system, raising money to put a new system? It's like, how are we going to see the end and the light at the end of the tunnel? It feels really great in the moment, but if we do post evaluation and we go back and we actually 10 years later say, are those systems in place? There's about a 50 to 60% failure rate, depending on where you are, which country you are in the world, in terms of these systems. So if you think about the sustainability, and we're working so hard to raise money and working so hard to get communities involved to do these projects, but they're not lasting, is this really the right solution? And so that was really sort of his, I think, the moment in which he realized that business as usual is not, like, this can't be the way. There's not enough philanthropy in the world to dig a well for every community anyway, so we have to figure out a different way to solve this problem. And that's, I think, where the social entrepreneurship angle comes in. So Gary really thought about the problem a little bit differently. Instead of looking at people, communities, as just true recipients of charity, really looking at them more as participants and being active citizens, accountable with rights and with responsibilities, that they themselves should be developing their own solutions. Who are we to come in and actually put in a system? Now, to some degree, there will always be a need for charity to some people in the world who are ultra poor, who are very rural, isolated, but charity is not a blanket approach. People are not equally poor. So if you think about it, how many, you know, people are surviving, right? There's 780 million people every single day that have to scavenge for water, but they are surviving. How are they surviving? People have some disposable income and or resources. They're either walking for water, which is their time, or they're paying for water. So you use the example of having to, once after all that work, then you're actually even paying for water. So households can spend up to 20% of their disposable income. Households who are $5, by the way, making $5 or less per day. So that is the bottom of the economic pyramid. So people who are poor, the bottom of the economic pyramid, are spending up to 20% of their household income on water and or sanitation services. So if you think about it, how all of that money is sort of off the grid, right? People are spending it black market, their water trucks, they're paying at the tap, they're walking, they're spending all of this time. So how do we capture all of those resources and pull it into the system? right? So there's all this money going into the system. There's governments investing in infrastructure. There's World Bank and IEDB and IFC who are all investing in these big projects. There's all this charity that's going into the system. There's foundations that are investing tons of dollars in terms of grants, right? But no one is saying, look at all of the people who are living this every single day and all of the resources that are sort of untapped, right, that are outside the system. How do we bring them into the fold and really make them customers and do and really look at this as market correction? Because this is really about market failures, right? So this is where the concept of water credit came in and saying, if you could give someone access to financing and say, here's a $150 loan, rather than we all pool our funding and we dig a well, we say, actually, we'll give you a loan and then you can pay it back and you can buy the solution that makes sense to you. You can go to your local utility and you can request a hookup into your home. You can buy a rainwater harvesting tank. You can build with a local mason. You can build a toilet in your home. Whatever you decide to do and whatever makes sense to you, we'll just work with you to get you that loan. And so water.org really took a total pivot from where it was 12 years ago and said, instead of being more of the traditional water and sanitation NGO, where we go in and we're a bunch of engineers digging wells, what we're going to do is actually partner with microfinance institutions. And we're going to become really smart about microfinance. And we're going to work with these institutions who are already banks to develop new loan portfolios and products so that people can actually take out loans. So we've gone from an entire staff of engineers to half a staff of engineers and half a staff of finance experts, which has been an interesting shift for water.org. So the idea here is that the micro lender, when they lend a loan to a family, a household, it takes about 18 months on average for that loan to get repaid. And when that loan is repaid, it goes back to the micro lender, and then the lender then redeploys it again. And so it's this cycle of redeployment. So instead of philanthropy going into a system one time and one time only, it goes into a larger ecosystem and it's repaid and redeployed and repaid and redeployed, et cetera, et cetera. So about 90% of all borrowers are women, and that is by virtue of microfinance. For any of those of you who are familiar with microfinance, predominantly borrowers in microfinance are women, and so by virtue of that, most of the borrowers here are women. It also doesn't surprising because most of the people who are affected by the global water and sanitation crisis are women. It's also not surprising because for every dollar invested in a woman, there's about a $6 return in terms of family productivity. Globally, women tend to invest in their families when given the opportunity. To date, water.org has used this model. We call it water credit. And about 140,000, 142,000, the loans, at any point in time, I can go on to a database at water.org. It's a password-protected site, and I can look to see how many loans have been deployed in real time. So loans are being deployed all over the world in real time. So this number is always ticking up, but about 142,000 loans globally. We've done the comparison in terms of how many people can be reached with water credit versus more of that traditional approach, and it's about 5 to 10 times more people in a 10-year period can be reached with water credit than if you just were to go into one community and do that well or rehabilitate that one system. So that's about 600,000 people. So of the 142,000 loans, when you think about average family size, in the different countries where we operate, that's about 600,000 people in a very short amount of time, comparatively. So we've been operating water credit since 2008 in earnest. We really started seeing the acceleration of water credit in 2010. And so it's really not been that long, 3 to 4 years, where we've really started to double down on this model and been able to scale it. So in the early days, you know, it really took some venture philanthropists, some really venture-minded investors to come with us for this journey, because they were like, so let me get this straight. You're gonna give a loan to someone who's very poor, who has no collateral, and you're gonna give them a loan for something that is static in the home, that's not income generating, because generally speaking, microfinance is for income generation, right? So you give a loan to a family, they buy a woman may buy a sewing machine, she may buy a cow, that's sort of the image of microfinance that many people have, and so that's income generating, it makes sense. But water and sanitation, you're building a toilet in your home, that's not income generating. So how would someone even pay that back? And so we've really had to bring people along, including these banks, because banks, by the way, were not on board with this. We've really had to get them to come along and hedge some of their risk, because we know and believe inherently that this is a priority for people. That if you ask a family, you know, if they have no running water and they have no electricity in their home, if you ask them what they want first, they need water first and foremost. So the data shows us that this is a priority, and people are spending resources, either capital, actual capital in their pockets, or their time. So this, they will make this a priority, and people will pay this back. And we know this because to date, it's about a 98% repayment rate. So we've shown market demand, and we've shown actual repayment. People are not only willing, but they're able to repay these loans. And so how are they repaying these loans? Well, we frankly, philosophically, don't really believe in spending a ton of funding to go back in and do a bunch of reevaluation of the people who are taking out these loans, and why are you taking out this loan? How is it that you're repaying it? Why are you repaying it? We see it, the proof is in the pudding, as they say, and people are repaying these loans. It's not really on us to say, why are you doing this, and really investigating further. If people are more economically productive because they have time on their hands and therefore they can then pay back those loans, that makes sense. If people are spending less in healthcare costs because they're not getting sick and they're not having to spend funds on seeing the doctor every month, then that makes sense too. So we really look at the repayment rate as a key metric in terms of whether this is actually working. So the way that it works, and for those that are really interested in the modeling, Water.org raises funding from foundations and individuals and on our website. So we raise funds philanthropy in, right? What we do then is we work with the microfinance institutions and we say, this works. We think this is a financially viable loan portfolio that you guys should get into, because not only will it provide a financial return, but it's good for your clients. It's client diversification, and it's also great in terms of just serving your clients, right? So what do the clients need? At the end of the day, water and sanitation is a very basic need. And so what we do is we provide what we call smart subsidies to that MFI, the microfinance institution. We don't provide any of the loan capital because we really want to make sure that the market is responding to market demand. So what we do is we hedge their financial risk up front. We cover a lot of sunk costs like market research, product development, demand surveys, baseline studies, all of the sort of soft costs that go into creating a new loan portfolio. Yes.
Is groups like Remy and Kiva?
So Grameen is a large sort of holding company bank that holds many different MFI institutions. And so it's more of an overall brand name for all of the banks that are sort of operating in the field. So yes, in that case, we are working with those types of banks. Kiva, on the other hand, is a no-cost capital provider to MFI. So they are not themselves providing the loans. They work with a whole network of microfinance institutions in the world. And what's interesting about Kiva, actually, is because of their value proposition, which is to provide capital, loan capital, for free to MFIs, the MFIs that they're working with predominantly are smaller institutions that have a really hard time accessing capital from the market, and so they go to Kiva. And so Kiva is actually an interesting partner that we've been working with in order to be able to work with MFIs that are really out there, that are in the trenches, that are working with communities that are incredibly rural and isolated, typically, and very hard to reach. And they are often also working with the most bottom economic rungs of the pyramid. So we're talking $2 or less a day. So it's actually an interesting diversification strategy for water.org to be able to work with MFIs that are working even farther out than sort of at that $5 to $3 a day income bracket. That's a great question. So what we do is we sort of provide them with those soft costs, and then they will probably hire a local water and sanitation NGO, because banks are banks. They're not engineers, right? They don't know the difference between this toilet's constructed soundly, this toilet is not constructed soundly. This needs a double tank, toilet. This is only a single, right? Or this is a septic system, this is a biogas filter system. Like they don't, those are the questions that they don't even want to get into, so they'll outsource a lot of that. So a lot of, in terms of what I was talking about for water.org, we monitor the repayment rates. We also do post-evaluations of the actual systems to make sure that the products that we're developing with these microfinance institutions are the right products. So we often go back and we actually figure out and make sure that the engineering is sound. So these microfinance institutions will then go to the banks once all of the products are ready to go. They'll go to the banks and say, we need X amount in bulk lending. They're usually MFIs going to the capital markets and getting bulk lending, not just for their water and sanitation portfolios, but for their entire banking portfolio. And then they'll allocate some portion of that to their water and sanitation portfolio, and then they'll make those loans to the households. Households then get that loan, and then they themselves will go out onto the market and purchase whatever product or service that they're looking for. So oftentimes, it really depends on where it is, but oftentimes, like in India, for instance, we're working in more urban or peri-urban areas, folks want a household connection. Like, that's done. They just want a household connection. So what they'll do is they'll contact the local utility, and the utility will come out and say, okay, you live this far from the road, it's going to cost X amount of dollars for that piping and that connection. Okay, you live this far from the road, it's going to cost this much from that, from the road and from the piping. So the lines are there. So you guys may, seen photos, especially in like big slums where these big, huge sort of pipes are running through the slums, and kids often will walk along those pipes. A lot of times people will bust into the pipes in order to actually siphon the water. So we know that the infrastructure is there oftentimes, but the predominant thinking is that people who are poor and living in these unnotified slums or undocumented slums can't afford a connection, let alone a monthly payment. But the reality is it's far cheaper for someone to actually get that $127 loan and get a household connection to their home than it is every single day trying to queue for water, walking for water, paying the water truck that's going by, if you can even catch the water truck that's coming by, right? So this is essentially the ecosystem that we're creating here. Yes.
Thank you. I was wondering, since it's a loan, do they have to pay back interest, and what is the interest rate if they have to pay back?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the interest rate varies anywhere from 10 to 24%. Microfinance itself is a very capital intensive industry. You are typically, as an MFI, you're hiring loan officers who are on bicycles, who are going out to communities and who are collecting repayment by hand and often documenting in paper, pencil, and then going back to the head office and putting it all on the computer. So it's a very capital intensive process, and so interest rates tend to be very high, especially because of the risk. So people oftentimes don't have a credit score. So in India, for instance, the microfinance sector, that's been a really robust initiative to create some kind of credit scoring system, because then people don't know oftentimes, I'm getting a loan from different MFI lenders, right? And so unless the MFIs themselves can talk to each other and say, that person took out a loan. Well, that person took out a loan from me too. And so now all of a sudden that person's taking out 10 different loans from 10 different organizations without some kind of credit scoring system, they don't really know. So there are, in mobile banking also, has really sort of taken down the cost, right? So there's different innovations that are happening and different systems that are coming together within the microfinance sector to bring those costs down. But we really defer to the MFI. We would want them actually to be charging market rates, because we really want to demonstrate the ultimate hypothesis here is that people who are living on $5 or less a day are customers and citizens, and they should be treated as such. They shouldn't be treated as a beneficiary of a charitable handout. They're really, that's not what they're even in fact interested in. At least our research shows us, the focus groups that we do, the market research that we do. And so unless the MFI, the microfinance institution, charges a market rate, then if they charge 12%, but the market rate's 20%, then they're really sort of shooting themselves in the foot and sort of shooting sort of the whole effort in the foot, frankly, because we want to be able to demonstrate that this is a market opportunity and that it doesn't require charity forever and ever and ever.
So how are they returning the money for people with such low income?
Mm. Yeah, right, so that's the question, and that was the question I think that microfinance institutions first said, there's no way. How are people able to pay it back if they're not generating an income? But what we're seeing is a 98% repayment rate, and the focus groups that we do, what we're seeing is that it's reduced healthcare costs, and so they have more money in their pocket. They're paying less for water and sanitation long term. So if you are living in an area where you're getting most of your water from the water tanker trucks that come by, first of all, the prices fluctuate. It's sort of at the mercy of whatever time of day it is. So if you're at the end of the day, or if you're at the end of the truck can also charge you more for whatever that last jug of water is, right? So you could be paying, let's say, out of pocket, $2 out of your own pocket for just a jerry can of water. So if you're paying daily for water, that really racks up. So it can be up to 20% of your disposable income. If you have a water tap and you're paying a monthly fee or a monthly bill of $2 a month, that's a huge savings. So we often say it's not income generating, but income enhancing. And so folks are actually finding opportunities also to pay back those loans through entrepreneurial activity. So a lot of times, once someone gets a tap in their home, they'll sell water to their neighbors. Or if someone has a toilet in their home, they'll charge a small fee for their neighbors to come and use their toilet. So there are other income generating activities. We're finding that mostly in Kenya, actually. We've seen some of that in Bangladesh, but for the most part, I think it's generally income savings on the back end, which is enabling them to pay back their loans. Yes?
I think also on the same point, I think a lot of us are blown away by your repayment rate here.
Mm-hmm.
I was wondering, I assume that the microfinance institutions are the ones who are actually approving the people for the loans.
That's correct.
Can you speak a little bit to what their criteria are for accepting people in case, I don't know exactly what, sans a credit score, which you were just discussing, what are the criteria that they use?
So it's a great question. The microfinance institution does do all of the credit scoring and the credit rating of that individual. Typically, a water and sanitation product or a loan is not the first loan product that you would take as a client. So how many of you guys are familiar with microfinance, generally speaking? A couple of you guys. So you guys would know that it's really a social collateral framework. Right? So the way that it typically works is that you go to the bank with your three friends and you say, we're all here together, we don't have any collateral, but we're all going to sign on the dotted line. And so I'm going to take out the loan and my two friends here are going to also sign and sort of as collateral, essentially, as backers of my loan. And if I don't pay back the loan, if I default, then the bank's not just coming after me, but coming after my two friends. So in communities of really tight community sort of framework that you would never sort of your word and your honor is the sort of your brand, right? And so to default on your there's very low default rates. It's called a joint liability group or a self-help group, right? So that's typically the model of microfinance institutions. With MFIs, as I was mentioning before, when you first take out that loan, your third or fourth loan is usually your water and sanitation loan. And the reason being is just your point, right, in terms of actually how credit worthy is that person. So if that person has taken out one to two different loans already and they've demonstrated that they can repay, then they're eligible for this type of product. MFIs, by the way, water and sanitation products is not the only sort of product diversification in terms of microfinance. There's energy products, there's loan products for schools. So if you want to send your kid to school, you can now take out education loans. Some MFIs are even experimenting with mortgages. So this is not the only type of diversification, although it's probably the most successful in terms of actually being able to charge market rate because people are paying so much. I think next to energy, because people spend a lot of time and energy collecting wood and buying kerosene. And for those of you guys who have a public health background, you would know also that polluted air from indoor stoves is also a major health risk and crisis in countries where people don't have access to clean energy. Did you have a question?
The question is, you told us about these micro investments, right? Mm-hmm. And what do they get back? They lend money to people. And as it is a commercial transaction, what do they get back?
So I didn't understand that point. So you're saying when the bank gives out the loan, what does the bank get back?
No, I'm telling about these micro investments.
Yeah.
What do they get back? You know, they lend money to people, but do they get something back or only the money back? Do they have
a
plus?
They're getting the principal plus interest.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're making revenue, the bank is. So we, back to sort of my earlier comment, and just in terms of really trying to prove the model. So this is our hypothesis, right? We want to prove that people are actually able and willing to pay for services. Big picture, we would like to demonstrate to the big development banks and to country governments themselves that expanding infrastructure and investing in infrastructure in rural and or poor communities, especially slums. So a lot of times this is a land ownership issue. So if you're trying to get connections for people, water connections for people, or build toilets for people in the slums where they are technically undocumented and they don't own the land, that becomes a land ownership issue. And so it becomes really about sort of land rights. And so what we're really trying to demonstrate is that this is a financially viable model and that it would be in the best interest of both the service providers, whether they be publicly or privately run, so owned by the government or privatized, best interest of those service providers and the governments themselves to invest in a model like water credit. Because it's less expensive, you're reaching more people, you're reaching people faster, it's sustainable, and it gives people the dignity of being able to be a customer of a product or a service rather than having to just wait for the handout, the free toilet, the free water tank, whatever. So we, unless the MFIs, the microfinance institutions, charge a market rate, which means they're giving a loan but you have to charge interest, unless they're making some revenue, then we don't have the model right. So that's why we really encourage microfinance institutions to actually charge a market rate. And so as people pay back the 98% repayment rate, it's very telling. So water.org is doing this, and we're executing on this model, and we're demonstrating and trying to scale the model. We're moving into new geographies in the next year, taking the lessons we've learned in India and Kenya, Uganda, and we're trying to move into other countries like Peru, Indonesia, Philippines. We're executing ourselves, but we, water.org, will never reach every single person with this model. Like, we don't have visions, grand visions of scaling to like be some $100 million organization so that we're executing water credit in every single country. We want to give the model away. We want to tell every single person, every organization, all of the development banks, governments. So advocacy is a really big part of what we do in terms of not just doing the work, but then also advocating on behalf of the model. Yeah. So this, I have this photo of just one example of a family recently who took out a water credit loan for a toilet. So this is Ronnie. In the blue, this is her oldest daughter who just had a baby. When I met her, she was not born yet, this little nugget here. She was pregnant. And they had not had a toilet in their home, and they were, all of the women were typically waiting till after darkness to go to the bathroom outside. The father, he was working mostly through the day, and sometimes he would travel. He would do contract work in other countries, or in other cities. So oftentimes the girls were alone with their mother. And so they were, especially when her daughter got pregnant, I can't remember her name off the top of my head. When her daughter got pregnant, it was especially challenging because, of course, as you're a pregnant woman, you have to go to the bathroom all the time, like every 10 minutes, right? So of course throughout the night, they were like getting up and they were going together because she didn't want to let her daughter go out by herself. And so this was sort of the last straw. Like she was like, this is it. Like we have to build a toilet in our home. Like, and she convinced her husband to allow her to go back to the MFI that she had borrowed from a year before, which had been successful, and take out a loan for a toilet. It took about 12 months, so the baby had already been born, unfortunately, it didn't go fast enough, but it took about 12 months, but they built a toilet in their home, and so now they don't have to go, they don't have to walk, they don't have to wait, and they feel, especially the mom, feels really good about it because her youngest daughter now doesn't have to go outside. And they're not, and it's also just the pride of being a household in the neighborhood that actually has a toilet in the home. It's very sort of, it's a dignified thing, and not everybody has a toilet. And so oftentimes she allows her other neighbors, especially when pregnant, to come and use their toilet. So I just wanted to sort of put it, give you a face, give you a, sort of a, this is actually a real family, and this was, I mean, she shared the story with me, and I was really appreciative to just kind of, I don't know, just hear sort of her, from her perspective, just the pride she had, especially in as her younger daughter is coming of age. So this was just a recent trip I took to India, yes.
You talked about this being used for revenue generation as well. Do you have cases of people taking these loans and using it for commercial purposes to provide, to run a business of toilets or water or something along those lines?
We have a couple case studies, especially in Kenya, actually, with water, in selling water from their home. It's not the norm. It's not, it's typically, if you're going to, so the reason why is this. If you have a household connection, just because you have a household connection doesn't solve the problem of 24-hour service. So having a household connection is better than having to walk for water, but oftentimes infrastructure is not fully pressurized. The whole system is not fully pressurized. So this is getting into a little bit of like technical detail, but one of the things that we're working on is we're getting more people connected to the grid. The grid pressure is coming down, right? So WeWater.org, I mean, like now we're talking like large scale infrastructure and the country of India having to invest in their infrastructure so that we can keep pushing water through the system. So oftentimes, having that household connection means you don't have to just leave the tap on and just pray because you don't know when the water is going to come on. You can basically just collect the water and you can have that for your household. So it's typically not enough when you have that connection to be able to provide water to not just yourself, but then to have be like almost like a kiosk, right, and have like a business. In Kenya, where we are seeing more rainwater harvesting tanks being sold, I mean, it's like the manufacturer can't keep up with the demand. We are seeing some instances where people are being entrepreneurial in their own community and they're selling water from their home. So that oftentimes is environmental though, when you have like larger, when you have a lot of rain, and if you're buying larger tanks, right? So if you have a 10 gallon tank versus a 20 versus a 50, so it depends on the size of the tank. So we are seeing some instances of that, and I think there's real promise and opportunity, especially in the rainwater harvesting tank business, for that. And we've seen it in sanitation too, in terms of, I don't know how much you guys have heard about this, but there's a sort of a whole new sort of trend or movement towards eco toilets, in that we're not using flush toilets and we're actually, we are harvesting human manure, and we're actually using it for other sources. So there's new businesses that are sort of sprouting up in terms of waste removal and then repurposing that waste and selling it for other purposes. So that is actually a business opportunity. There's an organization called Sanergy in Kenya that's doing some really interesting stuff on that front, if that answers your question.
It does, thank you.
Yeah. So I wanted to show you guys a quick video, if you don't mind.
If you don't know about the water crisis, you should. 2.6 billion people are affected. They lack clean water and a toilet. Each day, kids miss school, moms walk miles, families get sick from unsafe water, and too many die. Over 4,000 kids every day.
For those days we felt like a mistake.
We all know this is wrong, it's tragic, and it's totally unnecessary. Because it's solvable, if done right and with urgency. At water.org, we are dedicated to solving the global water crisis. Our more than 25 years of experience has given us insight. We know the water crisis can't be solved by a one-size-fits-all approach. We know it's not just about drilling wells, and that charity alone won't ever solve the challenge. To us, people in poverty are citizens and customers with rights and economic power, not just people in need of a handout. They want to determine their own future. Our role is to make this happen. So we go to communities who ask for help. With our local partners, we tailor programs to meet their needs. We engage innovative supporters. We bring in new sources of capital. Our solutions are built to last and must extend to other places quickly. And we develop game-changing ideas. One idea we pioneered is water credit. Water credit is a small loan for a family or community to get a water connection or a toilet. We convinced banks to make loans that weren't being made by sharing the financial risk with them. This brought new funds to people in need. And guess what? The idea works. And as the loans are being paid back, the money is recycled to others in need. Water credit is taking off around the world because it benefits more people faster. That makes it a solution critical to ending the crisis. Look, we have to be bold to solve the water crisis. Ensuring that everyone has safe drinking water and the dignity of a toilet is one of humanity's most urgent problems. The water crisis is complex, and we understand it. Let us work on your behalf, proudly. At water.org, we're dedicated to solving the water crisis in our lifetime. You can help make this happen. Join us.
So the other thing I just wanted to point out too is that not only are we doing this in water credit, but part of our remit in not just trying to document, to scale the model, is also to raise awareness about the global water and sanitation crisis so that more people sort of generally have a sense of what this challenge is and how they can get involved. So you'll see in our YouTube channel, Matt Damon goes on strike. He held a toilet strike. I don't know how many people saw that a couple months ago. And we had some celebrity friends, Jason Bateman, Jessica Biel, Josh Gad, and some other folks who did some really funny PSAs. And so I wanted to show you guys those PSAs, but you'll have to go to our YouTube channel to check it out. So we're trying to not just do the work and be serious about the work, but then also recognizing that you can't be serious all the time and have people want to come along with you. You actually have to make it appealing and fun to some degree. And so we've been experimenting not just with, you know, models sort of on the ground, but models of advocacy and using comedy, for instance, to try to get people's attention and be able to actually come along with us. So that is essentially water.org and our sort of theory of change, our model. I would just leave sort of this slide here as just about water.org a little bit in terms of when we were founded. Matt Damon is also one of our co-founders. He and Gary met in 2006 and then merged the two organizations in 2009. And we've had pretty significant growth since then, but we did have some really early stage venture philanthropists who came along with us, who really helped us demonstrate that water credit model, and now we're really scaling it with institutional funders like the PepsiCo Foundation, MasterCard Foundation, IKEA, et cetera. And that really enabled us last year to launch what we call the New Venture Fund, which is a separate pot of funding over here, which is really for that continued early stage investment from the venture philanthropists who want to invest in the next groundbreaking model. So what's that next water credit? And that's kind of our idea lab over here. And just basically ending with our vision of we think that we can solve this crisis in our lifetime, that it's really just a series of market failures, that if we think outside the box and leverage philanthropy a little bit differently to catalyze larger solutions, that we could actually see the end of this in our lifetime. If you can imagine 100 years from now, we had the cure for HIV/AIDS, but there was still a child under 5 who died every 21 seconds from HIV/AIDS because we didn't have the delivery system to be actually deliver the cure, the vaccine or the ARVs. Think about how sort of just ridiculous that sounds, right? If we had the cure, we would certainly get it to every single person, right? Water and sanitation is that. We don't need to wait for a cure and some scientific breakthrough. We actually know the engineering and we know the solutions. We just have to have the will to actually get them those solutions out there. So we think that this is certainly possible. Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering if water.org plays any role in education of people about water issues, I guess, on the ground, both from the aspect of how they can treat their water in the places that they are without a microloan, without the infrastructure that you're trying to build, and I guess an education aspect of the fact that they can even get these microloans. Like, where, how do these people find out that they can get them?
Yeah, so it's a great question. The microfinance institutions themselves do their own product marketing. So some of that upfront cost that I was saying that we help provide, we fund and cover those costs, some of that is what they would call marketing. Some development NGOs may call it community mobilization or demand generation. It's all the same, right? So it's really, it's marketing both the product as well as helping communities understand the need. So open defecation is culturally one of those tricky things. Depending on where you are, it can be culturally, you have to really nuance it, right? So some folks, I've gone to places where it's like, I am not going into that toilet. Like, there is no way you can pay me enough to go into that toilet. It's gross, right? So why would anybody, like, there's sometimes this sort of like, why would I go in a box when I have this beautiful field, right, over here? Like, I love to camp, right? So I get it. Like, I would never want to go into that box, right? But you really have to do some of the cultural sort of sensitization sort of training, right? So community-led total sanitation, CLTS, is one of those models where it's really about working with the entire community to understand that if just one of you guys practices open defecation, it ruins the whole system. We all have to be on board. So in some ways, it's a practice of sort of public shaming and wearing the scarlet letter. Like, if you are the one person in the community where you practice open defecation, the community sort of identifies that person. And so that's really a community-led model and process, and that's been a model that has seen really good results, and it's a model that has sort of been stamped of approval, verified by the World Bank, and so that's really been a model that has taken off. So there are, the microfinance institutions themselves really have to find the marketing resources to be able to do that kind of work. We will support them in doing it, but water.org themselves is not going out and doing the community-based work. We would rely on our local partners to do whatever is culturally appropriate for those communities. Yes, sir.
For the funding that you provide to the MFIs to facilitate their lending, how do you guys get that money? Is it through philanthropy, through fundraising?
Yeah, so that's where our fundraising comes in. So we are raising total philanthropy. We don't take on any debt as an organization ourselves, and that's essentially we help our MFI partners access that debt from the commercial markets. So what water.org is raising is strict philanthropy that helps us to run the programs and actually provide those smart subsidies to our partners. So we raise funds on our website, sort of grassroots funds. We raise money from small to medium-sized family foundations, and then we also raise funds from larger foundations, institutional funders. That's really where the bulk of this comes from, is in terms of support for the water credit model, is the institutional funders. So as I mentioned before, like the PepsiCo Foundation, MasterCard Foundation, those types of organizations that really come on board in like 2, 3, 5 year increments, right? So multi-year grant agreements to execute water credit over a period of time. Because if you remember, the repayment of these loans is about 18 months. So in order to really see a full cycle of water credit loans to sort of go out the door, come back, be replenished, go out the door, you're talking 3 years, 4 years. So when we try to find these institutional partners, we're really not just for the programs, but also for the health and sort of stability of the organization, water.org, looking for multi-year commitments. That answers your question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
When I studied microfinance and the Grameen Bank and all that in my SOC classes, they were looking at how empowering women in a lot of communities actually became dangerous, especially if their friends were collateral and there was just a lot of like community violence and all that.
Yeah.
So is there evidence that water.org is kind of shielding against that somehow in the local communities? for the repayment of the loans?
Yeah, we ourselves have not seen any evidence of that, in particular with our MFI partners. It's interesting, I've been working in microfinance for almost 7 years, and I have definitely seen a difference and a shift in terms of that self-help group model, the sort of social collateral fabric model. That really was born from Dr. Muhammad Yunus in Bangladesh, and that I've seen that shift over time and going more towards individual lending, the microfinance space, which gets to the point of saying, well, if you're going to go from this sort of social collateral model to individual lending, you really have to have the larger infrastructure of credit scores, for instance, social security numbers, for instance, the types of infrastructure we have in this country, if you can imagine that kind of infrastructure for individual lending, whatever that might look like in India or other countries. And so that starts to get obviously a lot more complicated, but I have started to see that shift. I think as people have access to more information and more technology, frankly, I think we're starting to see people go from more group to individual lending preferences. I think ultimately, just as my ultimate preference would be to have a household connection in my home rather than having to walk even to an improved well in my community, I'd sort of rather just have it in my home. I think the preference long term is that I'd sort of rather take out my own loan individually than have to rely on my friends. So I've started to see that shift, but I don't think that it's broad scale at this point. I think we have to see a lot more momentum in terms of mobile banking before we start to see that really take hold. Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I have another question though.
Sure.
How are you able to ascertain that the household you're lending to spend the loan on the water infrastructure?
Yeah, so that's a good question. We do monitoring and evaluation for all of our programs. I said earlier before sort of a philosophical point of view in terms of evaluation and water.org. We don't generally believe in spending a lot of money and going door to door and making sure people are taking out these loans to purchase whatever it is they said they would purchase with it. There's a level of paternalism there, right? And so I think that I'll say personally, if someone takes out a loan and they pay it back, I'm happy. I'm fine with that. If you take out a loan and you intended to build a toilet with it, and you intended to, you know, get a water connection with it, and you ultimately decided, well, I'm going to spend less of that loan, I'm going to get a water tank, and I'm going to buy a mobile phone instead, because the mobile phone is going to help me get work, or it's going to help me with my job, or something like that. I believe in people making choices that are best in the best interests of themselves and their families, and so I personally don't believe in sort of the culture of really intense monitoring of every single development project that's out there in the world. That's just my personal view. With water.org, obviously, we do monitor because we want to demonstrate this model and we want to share this model with the rest of the world. So unless we're monitoring and we can actually fact check it, then it doesn't really do us any good. So we do random sampling of our water credit partners and of the clients that they're serving. Some partners we work with more closely, some of our larger partners we work with more closely because it's a larger portfolio, and so we believe that we can find more data within those larger partner sets than working just with some of the smaller ones. And some of our donors, frankly, have high thresholds, low thresholds for risk, and especially corporate foundations. So when you're working with corporate foundations, oftentimes those foundations, when they're making big grants and nonprofits, they're making public-facing statements to their shareholders that we are going to get 3 million people access to water and sanitation. So when a CEO of a publicly traded company makes a statement like that, their auditors want to know that they've actually met their commitment. And so some of those partners actually have lower risk thresholds, and we do much more rigorous monitoring for those programs.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you guys for all of your time.